Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. I hope you guys are doing good because I'm doing great, as you guys can see. So in today's video, I'm going to be telling you 7 unexplainable things that have happened to me, okay? Some of them are quite scary, some of them are just strange, but these are unexplainable incidences that sometimes I have a hard time wrapping my head around. So I'm going to be counting down from 7 to 1, okay? 7 being the least strange, and 1 being the most strange, okay? So please do well to watch to the end of this video to hear what the number 1 is. Number 1 is something that I don't think anybody can explain it to me. I don't know how anybody is going to be able to explain number 1 to me. So the 7th strange or unexplainable incident that has happened to me in my life is that growing up, my mom always used to catch us doing the wrong thing, even when she didn't intend to catch us. Somehow, I always felt like I couldn't really hide things from my mom, okay? It's either she would dream about it and she would tell you. You might deny it though, like when she would tell you, I dreamt something about you, you would deny it and be like, where did that dream come from? But the truth is that you, deep down in your heart, you will know that what she's saying is the truth, okay? And aside just her dreams and, you know, her gut feelings and stuff like that, there were times when, let's say I get something from school that I'm not supposed to have, or something from school that, you know, I'm not supposed to bring home, and I hide it inside my wardrobe, my mom would just randomly enter my room for no reason or for a different reason. And for some reason, she would just go straight to where I hid that thing and start searching. Is that she's searching for something, or she just wants to look at, oh, this is your bag, I've not seen your school bag in a while. Like, it was so strange growing up. I'm not even sure she can remember this, but I remember it very well because I was like, how is this woman always catching us, okay? And the funny thing is that right now, it happens to me and my kids. And I always tell them, see, my spirit is very strong, okay? Don't think you can hide anything from me, because if you hide it, I'm going to find out. And the truth is that I always find out. And I always find out in the most strange and, you know, unexplainable ways. So let me know in the comment section if any of you have such superpowers, okay? Or maybe it's just a mom thing. Let me know in the comment section, okay? I'm sure so many of you can relate. During pregnancy, I dream all sorts of dreams, like very, very strange dreams and very, very vivid dreams as well. Like, they feel real, okay? So one of those days, while I was sleeping, I had a dream about a Korean guy, okay? Now, mind you, I don't watch Korean movies or series or whatever. I'm not interested. They all look alike to me. I don't know if that sounds racist, but that's the truth, okay? One of my girls is always watching Korean movies, and each time I pass, I'm like, is this not the movie I saw you watching before? And she's like, no, it's a different movie. I'm like, I don't know how you guys can tell all of them apart, okay? So that's even recently, but even before now, like, I never used to watch anything Korean, right? I was dreaming, and I dreamt I was in this romantic relationship with this Korean guy, and he was so strange, right? It was such a strange dream. We were in a romantic relationship, and, you know, other than all that. And you know how vivid pregnancy dreams can be. Like, I can actually, like, when you're in that dream, you can actually swear that that's reality, right? You won't know that you're dreaming. So it was such a vivid dream, and, you know, and all of that. Then I woke up, right? And when I woke up, it felt so real that I was like, no, this person must exist. This person must actually exist. Like, how did I, like, I could remember his face very well. I can remember his features very well. I can remember his voice very clearly. So when I woke up, I decided that I was going to Google him. I didn't know what to use as the search criteria. I didn't know what to type in Google search. And I started searching Korean actors, Korean male actors, Korean male actors that are popular, because I was like, maybe I have seen this person's face somewhere. But mind you, at that time, this was like 7 years ago, 8 years ago, 7 years ago, Korean movies were not as popular as they are right now, or at least in my circle, it wasn't popular. So I had no way of seeing who this person was. But I Googled it, and the face came up, and it was the exact person I saw in my dream. So strange. Like, when I say exact person, it was the exact person I saw in my dream. Really, really strange. If you've been watching my channel, you will know that I always talk about the power of imagination and how I use it to my advantage, okay? So I don't know how I even figured this out. This was even before I knew much about imagination or manifesting or things like that, okay? Or even about confession and things like that. I noticed that anytime I just stay and imagine something over and over and over and over again, somehow it's almost like things just align and I get that thing, okay? It might not be exactly how I imagined it. It might not be in the exact sequence that I imagined it happening. But somehow, I don't know. I don't know how to explain it. It's almost like I manifested those things without even knowing them, right? So because of it, it got to a point where anytime that I really want something, and I even still do it till now, okay, even though at some point I feel like I let it go a bit, but right now I reminded myself about it again. Anytime I really want something, maybe I want money, or I want a particular experience, or I want a particular, someone to do something for me, or someone to behave in a certain way, or for someone to even bring up a conversation so that I can now say what is in my mind. Like, you know how sometimes, and something I always say, how do I put it this way? I know how to delay conversations or gratification that comes from you giving back to somebody hot, okay? Sometimes, when something happens, some people try to, give it fire for fire, right? But someone like me, I know how to wait. I know how to wait and get you where, when I eventually now say my own part, like, there'll be no doubt in anybody's mind that I'm right, right? It will clear everybody's doubts in their minds that, or everybody's doubts will be cleared on whether I'm right or wrong, okay? So it might even be like, let's say me and somebody or someone does something to me and, I did not just give the person fire for fire there. I always say, don't worry, just wait. Opportunity will always come where it will now be your turn. First to do know the pain. Opportunity will always come where it will be your turn to do it back to that person. And at that time, when you now do it back to the person, you will not be found guilty. Like, nobody will see you and say, oh, why did you do? Like, everybody will understand why you did it. Okay, that's my point, right? So when such things happen, and I really want to address that issue, or I want the person to do something that will make me now address the issue, I start imagining the scenario in my head. I don't know if maybe I'm actually doing self-fulfilling prophecy, where because I'm thinking it somehow, I act in such a way that the person will now bring up that matter. I don't know, maybe that's it. But, anyway, I'm debating too much. Power of imagination, it works for me very well. I can't explain it. I can't explain how it happens. Sometimes, even when I get those things that I was imagining, okay, this is aside prayer, right? Because I also pray. But sometimes when I get those things that I was imagining at some point, I'll forget that one time I was imagining having this thing. Then one day, something will just trigger a memory. And I'll be like, oh my goodness, this was the exact same scenario I was imagining in my head. And this exact same scenario happened, okay? Yeah, so I can't explain it. Maybe it's an introvert thing because, I mean, I like to just be by myself and just be imagining, like, I have fun in my head a lot, okay? So maybe it's an introvert thing, but I don't know. But I feel like there's a power to imagination, or a power in imagination, okay? Now, the fourth one, strange but true incidents that happened to me is how I got my laptop back in university after it had been stolen from my room. I got my laptop back about 3 months after it had been stolen, okay? If you're familiar with my channel, if you've been watching me before, you will know that story, right? So I'm not going to go into details of that story, but just know that somebody came into my room, stole my laptop, and I was writing my final year projects then. And inside my laptop, I had all my documents. I did not have it on a flash. I think I was even preparing to transfer it to a flash during that period. Or I think I had like chapter one on a flash or something. I can't remember how the story went, but just know that I had almost finished my project and my project was on my laptop and my laptop got stolen from my room. I could even see the intruder's footprints on my carpet because I still have a very clean blue carpet, and the person walked in with brown sand under the person's feet. So I could see how the person walked around my room, like clear as day, walked around my room and collected my laptop and my phone that was beside my laptop, right? And I thought I was going to die that period. I felt so bad. I felt so angry because this was a fairly new laptop and all my project was on it and time was already going. I felt so sad. Anyway, long story short, I'm going to link that video below so you guys will find out how I got the laptop back. But the strangest thing that happened, which is why I'm putting it here, is that when I eventually got my laptop back, all my projects were on the laptop, all my images, all my videos, all my movies, all my documents, every single thing I had on that laptop was still intact, okay? Mind you, this was 3 months after, and this laptop had gone from hand to hand. Like, it was stolen and sold, and someone else bought it, okay? And still, the person did not even bother to format the laptop or erase any... When I say any document, I mean any... Like, when I put on the laptop, it was as if it hadn't been used, right? Now, the only evidence I had that this laptop had been used was that the people who stole the laptop, I don't know if they are Yahoo boys or whatever they do, but they used to engage in rituals. And there was a video on that laptop where whoever stole the laptop or whoever bought the laptop or whoever was involved in this whole laptop case was in a bush somewhere with his friend, and there was a man who was wearing a white cloth, and they killed, I don't know if it's chicken or goat, but there was blood there, and they were pouring the blood on their body, and they were making incantations and stuff, okay? That's the only evidence I have that this my laptop had been used. So it means that the guy, you know, had put his videos in my laptop, and he didn't even bother to delete my own. That's even the strange part. It's a very interesting story. You guys should go and watch it. I'm going to leave it linked down below. But yeah, that's how I got my laptop after 3 months, all my documents intact, and I just finished my project and submitted, and you know, here I am today, okay? Even though I cannot even remember my project topics, but yeah. We had this house help. I think I've done a story time on this. I'm also going to link it in the description box, right? But we had this house help that was living with us, and was apparently, she belonged to the marine world, okay? She had this marine spirit, and she engaged in, you know, occultic things and all these devilish things and, you know, mommy water things, okay? So for those of you who don't believe in all those things, or you don't believe in the spiritual, you know, angle of life, or you don't believe that all those things exist, don't believe in mommy water or witches and wizards or all those spiritual things, I'm sorry to break it to you, okay? But you are sleeping on a bicycle. All those things actually exist, okay? Now, the difference between me and some other people is that I know they exist, I believe they exist, but I don't care, okay? Because to me, they are nobodies, they are nothing in the grand scheme of things. I am greater than them, okay? Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world, okay? I believe so much in the power of you know, resurrection, in the power of Jesus, in the power of God, that I don't pay attention to all those things. Okay, but do they exist? Yes, they do exist. Do they have powers? Yes, they do have powers. Okay, but guess what? Guess whose power they use? They use your power against you. Okay, so when you believe in them and you are afraid of them, and you start, you know, either you believe in them to actually engage in what they are engaging, or you believe in them and you are scared of them, that is when they affect you. That's why you see that witches and wizards are always killing themselves in the village, but they cannot affect those of us in the town that don't care, I don't believe in it. They not sit down, go to go and affect. That was why we had witches and wizards and all the gods and stuff, and then the white man came and carried all those gods and took them back to their museum, and those gods are still there to today. None of them fell down and died. You know, the gods did not strike them dead, nothing. But if they were still in the villages, they'll be striking the villagers down, you know. So yeah, at the end of the day, those things exist, but I just don't believe in them. I don't believe in their power. I don't believe their power is greater than my own power. Do they have power? Yes, but my power as a human being is greater than their own power. Then top it up with, you know, the power of God and the power of resurrection and Jesus Christ and everything that, you know, being a child of God, my power is just immeasurable, okay? Anyway, so we had this girl that was living with us, and she confessed to a lot of things that were so strange. Like, she said she tried to initiate my mom, but the spirit told her that, you know, don't touch this family or don't go close to this family, something like that, okay? So from our house, she was doing things to other people in other places, right? But she didn't do anything to us in particular. My mom had a dream where this girl took her to a place where there were some old people doing some things that my mom did not just understand. And my mom said that in that dream, she was like, why are you bringing me here? I'm not interested. Please, I beg, I want to leave this place, or something like that. And anyway, it turns out that when they asked the girl in real life, like, did you try to initiate, you know, my mom asked her, did you try to initiate me? She said yes, that dream that my mom had was actually real. Like, it was her that tried to actually initiate my mom, okay? So several incidences like that. My father was asking her about occultic things that he had read in books, okay? Mind you, my father is very educated, you know, and he had read all these books at an older age, right? He read all these books at an older age, and, you know, he was just reading it for knowledge sake, right? Now, he was asking this village girl that came from the village that could barely, you know, she could read, but not like she was that fantastic at reading. Like, she came from the village. She was still going to school. I think she was in secondary school then, or just finished secondary school, one of those things. She hadn't even gone to uni. Basically, imagine a girl from the village telling you things that you have read, explaining to you things that you have read in occultic books, okay? In all these, not just occultic books, all these higher knowledge kind of books, right? Imagine a girl from the village that was, I think she was 16 at that point, telling you things you've read in that book, okay? Where did she get the knowledge from? Calling names of pastors, saying how she used to go to River Niger for meeting or something like that. I can't even remember all of the details because I was younger when it happened. But yeah, it was a very strange incident. Like, the girl said she used to look at my mom like, who is this one? Because in her own world, whether 7 years is like 1 year in their own world, right? So in her own world, let's say she had been there for 7 years, she was like 49 or something. Why my mom? She looked at my mom like, who is this one? So when my mom was talking to her then, she was like, you know how you're just looking at the person like, like you don't even know, you don't know who your mate is, that kind of thing. Okay, she even confessed to initiating guys into it, like when she's walking on the road, that she has two guys that people don't see that work with her. And if you're a guy and you look at her too much and she turns back and looks at you, that she can come and initiate you in the night. Okay, I don't know how true that one is, so I don't know if they embellished, you know, the story. That's if the girl embellished the story just for shock value or whatever, or to instill fear. But yeah, she confessed to putting her sister in one place where they were punishing her sister. She confessed to putting somebody else's house girl in that same place. And these two people that she talked about, they are very, very skinny and they look very hungry and, you know, like people that are being tortured, right? Anyway, believe the part you want to believe. I cannot verify the whole story. I was not there. I did not go there with her. I did not put anybody anywhere with her, right? But all I'm saying is that these are incidences that are not... You can't actually dismiss them completely, okay? You can't say they are not true. You can't say with your full chest that they are not true, okay? That's just it. A lot of times in my life, when somebody important to me or somebody close to me had died, I knew, I had a feeling it was going to happen. And when it happened, even before I was told, I had a feeling that it had already happened, okay? Now, I'll give you two instances so far in my life. Two instances. I've had other instances here and there that are not very clear. Like, you know, there are instances of you knowing that, oh, somebody is sick and the person might die. That's a different case. I'm talking about instances where the person was not sick, neither, you know, or if the person was sick, the person was not supposed to die from that sickness, right? Now, the first instance is my grandfather. I remember I've not told anybody this thing before, okay? So, yeah, it's weird I'm saying this here for the first time. My parents are going to watch this and be like, "We started again. You didn't even tell us. You're telling the whole internet." But anyway, before my grandfather died, I remember that I was in my cousin's house at that time. I went to my cousin's house for holidays. I went to, you know, spend time with her and all of that, right? And I remember that when my mom came to pick me from my cousin's house, we were supposed to go to the village. I don't know if I'm remembering this situation clearly, but we were supposed to go to the village and just go to the village, then go to Lagos from there. I can't really remember this scenario very well because, to be honest, I have not thought about this thing in years, so maybe that's why. But I just know that I was supposed to go to the village to see my grandpa with my mom, because that my cousin lived in Port Harcourt. So we're supposed to go from Port Harcourt to the village and then from the village back to Lagos, right? And I remember that I think plans changed. My mom was saying, okay, we won't go to the village again. We'll go straight to Lagos, right? And I remember having this feeling, this very strong feeling, that we better go and see my grandpa because this might be the last time we'll ever see him. Like, I can remember those words very clearly, okay? I remember those words really, really clearly. It said, I don't know if it was me saying it to myself or just an imaginary, just a voice, but I heard it very strongly saying, "You better go and see grandpa because this will be the last time you're ever going to see him." And mind you, at that time, my grandpa was not sick. He was old, but he wasn't that old. Actually, now that I'm older, I realized that he wasn't that old. I think he was 70-something or so. Yeah. So he wasn't that old. Okay. But I just had that feeling. We better go and see grandpa because this might be the last time you're going to see him. This will be the last time you're going to see him. And I remember feeling like telling my mom that. But I couldn't say it to her because how you want to explain, say, "Papa will soon die, so make me go see him." Like, mind you, I was just like, how old was I then? I was not even up to, let's just say I was like, maybe 13 or 14. Okay, that was my age around that time. Yeah, either 13 or 14. So, how do I want to go and explain to my mom that, let's go and see grandpa because this might be the last time I'm going to see him, you know? That was how we did not go and see him, and that was how my grandpa died after that, okay, shortly after that. And I think he died... he died after an accident. He had an accident. He fell from his bike and then, you know, went to the hospital and then treatment upon treatment, one thing or the other. Like, he broke his leg or so. One thing or the other, he eventually died, right? So, when that thing happened, I felt so sad. I felt like I should have just said something. I should have just gone to see him then because, truly, that would have been the last time I would have seen him. And knowing that would have been the last time I would have seen him, I would have cherished that moment with him more. But anyway, oh well, it happens. Now, the next one that happened with me, or to me, or yeah, the next one that happened was my auntie, who is also my godmother, okay? Now, my auntie, who is also my godmother, she had fibroid and she wanted to have a fibroid operation. Again, many people don't know, I don't know anybody that died from fibroid operation except for my auntie, right? But many people, is an operation people have all the time. I'm sure there are people that have had, that have died from it, but in this case, like, she wasn't expected to die from it. It was expected to go successfully, at least from the impression that we got, right? So, but I remember that she came to our house shortly before she went for that operation. And when she left, there was this book she left behind. And this book, I don't say the name of the church that had that book, right? But I remember one day I picked up that book and I wanted to read it. And I was like, why is this book this demonic? That's how I felt, right? Now, mind you, it's a prayer book. It's a book about prayers, kind of prayers, you know, prayers you should make, prayer points and all of that. But the book felt very demonic to me because I was seeing almost like 1,000 ways to die. That's how the prayers were. Like, let my father's people not suck my soul from my body. You know, I can't remember the words right now, but you know, kind of like 1,000 ways to die. That's how all the prayers are. Let sickness not cut my life short. Another, that's one prayer point though. Then the next prayer point is, let my father's people not, you know, kill me in my sleep. Another prayer point, let my neighbor not eat my heart out. You know, kind of, I'm just saying, but you know, if you know the church, if the way I said, let my, you know, not my father, you know, kind of prayer, if you know the church, you know the church. I don't call their name, but that was the church. That was the church that owned that book. And when I saw all the, I said prayer points were like 1,000 prayer points or something like that. It was a book, like it was a sizable book and was full of prayer points, right? And I remember looking at this prayer point and I was like, what's in the happen now? One prayer I never do, like, God give me life is not enough. You have to describe 1,000 ways to die. You know, I remember saying that. So when she went for this operation, I kept having this feeling that she will not survive it. She will not survive it. She's too afraid. She will not survive it. I could not say this thing to anybody. Okay, this is my first time actually saying it out loud. I kept having this feeling she will not survive it because she's too afraid. This book has put fear in her. She will not survive it. I didn't say anything. I didn't say anything to anybody. Maybe I should have said something. Maybe not. I don't know. I didn't say anything. Now, we heard that the operation was successful. And I was like, ah, thank God. Thank God. My intuition did not come to pass. Or whatever that thing is. It didn't come to pass. The premonition did not come to pass. Okay. So I remember feeling happy. Oh, thank God. Oh, she survived this. She was okay. She's out of the operation. You know, whether she was resting. I think somebody had gone to, it wasn't my auntie that had gone to stay with her, something like that. So that was, you know, that was that at that time. Now the next day, my mom's phone rang. You guys, this thing I'm saying, as I'm saying now, I'm feeling somehow. My mom was upstairs. Like, I remember it vividly in our house in Lagos, because we were living in a duplex in Lagos. So my mom was downstairs. Her phone was upstairs and her phone rang upstairs. The moment her phone rang upstairs, a voice just came to my head. That same voice that said, if you don't see grandpa now, you know, you'll never see him again. This voice said, auntie, I don't call her name, auntie, this is dead. I said, go for me. That's what I was saying in my head. I'm saying, go for me. What kind of thought is that one? And I'm used to doing that thing. When I get that kind of feeling, I'm like, go for me. Anyway, that's how I said, go for me. And then the next thing, my mom went to pick her call. And we now heard a shout. I remember my mom shouting, crying. And I was like, oh my God, it has happened. Auntie, this is dead. And guess what? That was it. That was the call that she received. She received a call that my auntie was dead after a successful surgery. That's number two. Now, number three is a very recent one. So this thing I'm saying, maybe I should have just done this in a different video. Anyway, this number three is a very recent one. Number three one was a month ago or 2 months ago. I remember I took my kids to a play. That was Easter egg hunt. Yes, I took my kids for Easter egg hunt. Now, when I took my kids for that Easter egg hunt, you know, they were playing around inside the playground. And I was chasing them around, like, I would go, maybe someone is playing in the jumping castle. I'll go to the jumping castle and, you know, play with them small. Then I'll go to where my children were painting. Other ones were painting. I think Kaora and Eva were painting at that point. Just know that each time I went to either when I went to the bouncy castle to talk to Sophia, as I'm coming back, I would smell, is it formalin? If you've ever been around dead body, like if you've gone for a burial and you've gone to see the body, or you've been in a room where they kept the dead body, there's one smell that's always in that room. Like, I can't forget that smell. Like, anytime I smell it, I know that smell. It's a distinct smell. Let me know in the comment section if you guys know that smell, right? So anytime I'll go there, if I'm passing, I'll smell it in this corner. It was a large field though. In that corner of the field, I'll smell it. Now I'll be walking up and down, I won't smell it again. Let's say I go to where Sophia is to, or Eva is to, you know, do something else. I'm passing again, I'll smell that thing again. Ah, you guys, I started praying, you know. I started praying because something kept telling me in my head, the spirit of death is around here. The spirit of death is around here. I was like, God forbid. I started praying. I started binding. I started casting. I started declaring. I said, if you see me, you will not know. Like, when you're watching me, you will not know. But I was not taking it, I was not finding it funny. I wasn't taking it lightly. Like, I was just, you know, speaking in tongues, praying, declaring, rebuking. Anyway, after a while, that one passed. Like, I didn't smell it again. My kids were having fun. We were done. We packed up and we left. Guess what? The next day, the parrot in my house flew to my neighbor's compound, and the dog in my neighbor's compound killed my parrot. Okay? I'm sure you guys did not see it ending like that, right? And this thing pained me. No, you guys, this thing pained me because this parrot, I love this parrot so much, and I really took care of those parrots. I actually bought food for my parrots, and the food is still here. That food is paining me. In fact, I could chop that food because it looks very nutritious. But anyway, it's funny now, I can laugh about it now, but when that incident happened, funny enough, when the parrot first died, I was heartbroken, not heartbroken in a very serious way. I just felt bad as I wasted money, and I really liked the parrot, and I was waiting for the parrot to grow and talk, you know, so that I can hear parrot talk. Anyway, when that thing happened, I didn't even think about the feeling I felt the day before. It was later on that something just said, that same voice told me, remember you felt that the spirit of death was around, right? Just remember that you felt the spirit of death was around. And I remember that, oh my God, yesterday, I actually felt this thing, you know. And for some reason, when I felt it, even though it was when I was with my kids, I did not think it was about my kids, okay? My kids are safe, please, I beg, God, I beg. I could not even think that kind of thing. But I didn't think it was about my kids. But I felt like where I was, like, there was death hovering around, and you know, something might happen there and somebody would die. Not my kids, though. But anyway, when I remember that I had that feeling and my parrot died, I'm like, thank God it's the parrot, okay? Like, it's parrots. I can replace it. I can buy new ones. In fact, I can buy 100 new parrots and start a parrot farm, okay? But thank God this was a parrot and not anybody, not a human being, okay? Okay, now, the last one. This is the strangest thing that has ever happened. And if you guys can explain it in the comment section, just go ahead and try and explain it, okay, when I tell you guys the story. If you have an explanation for it, please explain it. Now, let me sit down. Now, when my mom was pregnant with my elder brother, right? She said she was going out one day. I don't even know these details very well. Maybe I'm saying the wrong thing, but I think this is how the story goes, right? She was going out one day and she was, you know, trying to enter taxi. Well, she was going to school or something because she was a teacher. She was trying to enter taxi and the door of the taxi, something from the door of the taxi, dragged her dress and, you know, tore her dress and gave her an injury on her leg. It's either that or she fell. One of those two things, right? I'm not really sure of the exact details, but it's either... it was the door of the taxi. I think it's door of the taxi because I remember door of taxi very well. It's either the door of taxi or she fell. But anyway, just know that it gave her an injury on her leg and that injury left a scar, okay? Now, explain to me how when she eventually gave birth to my elder brother had a birthmark in the shape of that scar on the same place on his lap, okay? Now, I didn't say my mom had a birthmark. I said my mom had an injury. At old age, not old age, like she was already mature, older, she was pregnant with my elder brother, she had an injury. And that injury turned to a scar, and then she gave it to my brother, and my brother has a scar in the same shape on his lap, okay? In the same place where she got the injury. Now, that's not the strangest part of it all, though, eh? Let me tell you guys, just brace yourself. Are you sitting down for this? That is not the strangest part, because maybe... we can explain that one somehow. Somehow, he was in the womb when it happened. So maybe his DNA now, you know. somehow we can explain that one. Can somebody explain to me why Sophia, my third child, has a birthmark on her lap in the same position? I can show you guys the birthmark. Can you explain to me why Sophia has a birthmark that my elder brother has, that my mom has, but her own is an injury? Strange things are happening. Strange things are happening. There's one Yoruba movie, there's one Yoruba show I used to watch when I was growing up. Ni Kombe. I don't even know how I used to watch that show. I think it was translated. Yeah, I think it was translated because I don't know how I used to watch it. Something like Ni Kombe or something like that. Let me know in comment section the real song or pronunciation. Strange but true. This is a strange but true or something like that. Yes, you guys. So those are the seven strange things or unexplainable things that have happened or happened in my life. Let me know the ones that have happened in your own lives as well. If you guys have any strange stories, please, I really love to read them. I beg, don't say you don't like typing. I don't want to hear, oh, I don't like typing, I don't like leaving a comment. Please, I take God beguna, leave a comment. I will make sure I respond to every single comment, okay? I want to hear your strange stories. If you can relate to any of my own stories, if you have your own, if you can explain anything that I just said, okay? If you have explanation for it, then let me know in the comment section, okay? Yeah, that's it for today's video. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you all in my next video. Bye, guys.